Thank you, Jeffrey. Very kind words. It's great to be here. What a wonderful, unexpected venue. And a great crowd of you. So, I begin with floods. It's not a weather warning. It's a poem spoken by Roman colonist living in Egypt in the first century. And I'll just read the opening passage of it. But the world as a watery place was known to ancient peoples like the Sumerians, as well as to our own Ovid. And it makes sense when you think about it, since overnight puddles appear in the vineyard, a flash flood uproots an oak planted in the Punic Wars. We find the oats lodged, a nonagar drowned, the mullet fisher's boat upended. True, we associate rain with these occurrences, but it isn't what causes them, since rain has little impact on the earth. Something you can check for yourself if you dig the ground after a downpour. You'll find it dry just under the sod. Think then of great rivers, the Rhone and Danube, flowing winter and summer, year in, year out, from places where the rainfall varies. Where does all their water come from? Now consider another phenomenon, that the Nile, with its seven mouths, flows into the lower sea, and along with it countless lesser rivers, streams, canals, sewers, so that large amounts of water drain day and night off the land. Yet the sea doesn't rise, nor its saltiness diminish. A problem that baffled Aristotle, though the explanation is simple enough. And then he gives us the explanation, and that goes on for five or six pages, so I'll spare you that. But actually, when I was writing that poem in 1999, I think, I learned a new word, the word clepsydra, which Katrina used in her wonderful poem. Literally, it's a Greek word, and literally translated, it means water stealer. So that kind of gave me the title for a more recent book. And in fact, as that poem goes on, the speaker becomes, I don't know, it's a kind of a treatise of water, but it becomes increasingly more about time, and about the connection between water and time. So that kind of idea stayed with me, and I read the opening poem from The Water Stealer. It's called The Lull. It happened on the cinder path between the playing field and the graveyard one afternoon in October, when all the leaves of the aspen flipped over and stayed, the way a skirt might blow up and hold in a gust of wind. Except there was no wind. One of those days when the thud of a football hangs in the deadened air. But there was no thud, no sound from man or bird. So I'd swear if I'd looked at my watch just then, the digits would have stuck, if I could have looked. For it must have been a time when time was snagged in its fluid escapement, and in that lull no one can enter the world or leave it. The cars stand on the motorway, the greyhound's legs are knotted above the track, a missile is framed in mid-flight, no sound comes from the child's mouth, the open beak, and the shoal of herring is a sculpted cloud shimmering under the glass of the rolling downs. At this moment, when the joker palms the room key, the punching fist can be opened, the egg slipped back under the nesting bird, and each of us could scurry to forestall one mischance or undo one wrong choice whose thorn of consequence has lodged till now, before whatever it is keeps the world scary and true breaks loose. A squirrel turns tail overhead, a chestnut rolls to the ground, and with it a drawn-out scream arrives from childhood. The hare. The boy has come across fields to the ring fort, under the barbed wire, through the wet barley over the stream. He's listened to the stone chat and the thorn above Keith's well, and fingered the grass where a rabbit slipped out of sight. Now he approaches the mound and earshot of the river below. If only he could stop, he could balance the slender jerk of his body unspilled, while his thought turns in some dream of football or riding bareback across prairie, before he's waded into the shoulder-high wave of bracken onto the fort. And there, in the dip, where a hern or carny the knacker set the trap, the hare sits on her haunches, her nostrils twitching between fronds and thistles. So calm, it seems, he will gentle her in from the wild. When his shadow dulls the chestnut of an eye, and she jumps outstretched in air and free for a second, but held in the frame of her leap by the rusted teeth sunk into her hind leg. So the boy finds a stone as he must, smooth as carbolic soap, and aims to connect with the head. The hare, though, is quick, as she yanks and tosses the leg iron to herself unwounded, but she can't snap the raw bone from its grip. So now he's dense and accurate until the eyes go dim, a thread of blood loops from the mouth, and the hare lies before the boy, who will dream of the moon calf that leaned then from the bracken, and smirking took the stone out of his hand. Way back in 1995, we had a kind of in-house request at Faber to write a poem for Ted Hughes's 65th birthday, which was a bit of a tall order, really. But it was quite, you know. Anyway. I decided I'd write about a crow. except that I called the poem Bav. That's B-A-D-B. It's an old Irish word. It's the Bav was a crow goddess, goddess of the battlefield. So she was bad news, I guess. Bav. I was walking where the woods begin, with an almost sheer drop to the river, so that I was eye level with the tops of nearby trees and higher than the branch when I came upon the crow sitting there, so close I could have touched her with a stick. She was creaturely and unwary as the wind bore her away and brought her back. We share the same tangy woodland smells, the same malt-pale October sunlight. Then I must have made a sound, for she came alert and looked at me, and in that interval before the legs could lift her weight from the branch, as the beak sprang open to deliver its single rough vow, she held me off with a look, the sudden realignment of the eyes above the gawping mouth. It is the look known to legend and folk belief, though also an attribute useful for a bird without talons or guile to defend it. Then she was gone, in a few wing beats indistinguishable from her fellows wheeling above the trees, carrying on their business. neighborly, and otherworldly. And I'm going to fetch a poem from the ether about a little recollection of it uses fellow poet and great friend. We were sitting in the restaurant window when I heard myself saying, "Seamus is here," though there was no greeting and our view was blocked by a brewery lorry pulled up on the curb. I'd no sight of him, but it was nothing spooky either. What I had seen under the lorry were 2 feet passing on the other side. I'd known him by the gait, as one would by the voice. Yet I'd never before noticed his feet, and if asked, I might have guessed he had a fisherman's walk, slow and deliberate. But no, what I saw were the feet of a schoolboy, invisibly sandaled, stepping nimbly towards us. My kind of film quiz poem, which, if you've heard it before, you might spoil it by shouting out the answers to the quiz. So if you could refrain from doing that, and also keep away from your phones and stop Googling while I'm reading. It's called Gone with the Wind. I couldn't remember this morning who was Scarlett O'Hara, Olivia de Havilland, Hattie McDaniel, even Clark Gable came to mind. I recalled Olivier, I thought of Veronica Lake. In the end, I got up and Googled Gone with the Wind. I have this problem with names, celebs, exes, school friends, with people it seems, not places. Not the 30-odd townlands of Lisgood, Welshtown Bay, Corricomdon, Riusk. Later on my run, I recalled 48 of the American states. Wisconsin and Kentucky were the ones I missed. But the other night I could not remember Jodie Foster, though I chatted with her once in Leicester Square, an ordinary college girl, between being a child star and agent starling, queuing outside the Odeon for, could it have been the company of wolves? It bothered me all next day, several days, and then on a plane held above Knock Airport, I remembered. First, I felt the shadow of a bird across a lawn, a hint at how our lane would sound. There was a pause and a pressure building, but I knew I'd get there. It was physical, like ours after lunch, dislodging salami from a tooth. First the release, then the pleasure. Then it was hard to stop. I wanted to remember them all, not only things buffs know, but the support role in Once Upon a Time in America. That was Tuesday Weld. But who played Dolores Hayes? Who climbed the Trevi Fountain? Who was that blonde with Cary Grant on Mount Rushmore? Who said, "Is that a gun? Are you just pleased to see me?" Okay, Mae West. But why do I always first think Bessie Smith? Why does one good woman now hide behind another? Is there some kink occurring, a hindrance in my brain? After that, I recalled the entire line-out of Cork's 1966 All-Ireland hurling team, then went on to the rows of boys in Junior A, Rubberneck, Horse Buckley, Squirt, Brawny, Gentle Brendan, who died, whose nickname I will recall, as though the brain must give the rest of life, going over what's gone before, an unforgiving effort of retrieval. The cornfield I slept in near Pont du Raz, a sand quarry outside Donnerail, girls whose faces bogged to the surface from four white winters in Ontario. Let all of them be well, have prospered, each be loved, yet may there be the mercy of forgetting. But let me keep, to my last breath, those few I name before I sleep tonight. It's been a lovely afternoon. And thank you, Poets and Players, for inviting me. I won't detain you much longer. but it was especially sort of, I don't know, wonderful to share the audience with such inventive and soulful musicians, so thank you to Chris and Kirsty, and I think something of an inspiration to put the three of us together with so many crossovers about language and borders and interests and rare and unusual stuff. I'll finish with a poem that is about a sort of a rare, a unique object, I guess, Slow. In the early 90s, you may remember a body was discovered in the Austrian or German, the Austrian Alps in the Tyrol anyway. It was a bit of a mystery, whose body it is. Is it possible to say whose body it was? But anyway, it turned out to be a Neolithic man or woman, as it turns out, but at the time it was assumed that it was a man. One of the things that was discovered with the body was a frozen slow. So the scientist who sort of examined the body first, this marvelous kind of reconstruction of the life of this Neolithic man, but he didn't know that much about the slow, and I thought I did actually. I knew something about the slow because when we were children, my father, when we come across the slows, he would say, "They're too sour to eat, but when the frost comes, it will sweeten them." And then I knew as well that they were often found, that the stones were often found in Neolithic graves, so it kind of occurred to me that there probably were what's called viaticum, food for the soul after death. So I thought that might kind of be a way into writing this poem. It goes on for about 5 minutes, and I will conclude with that. That he died alone in the gully below the pass in a slow storm, the first of the year, in the lurch of the seasons which became a change of climate, that he died some 3 to 5 weeks after an assault from a wild beast or fellow man, which shattered his ribcage and sent him above the tree line, far from the settlements. That he died really from being alone an injured man relying on his few resources, which were, however, both innate and military, so that he carried about him not only weapons and tools, but spears, medicine, and a sewing kit, fire, and the means of fire, and was observant and skilled about stone, wood, grasses, skins, about staghorn and bone, knew for each its properties and use. But he died like Xenophon's comrades on the trek home through Armenia, as soldiers have died in all recorded winter marches, not from lack of discipline or the body's weakness, or not only, but because of the slight shortening of the odds which comes with the unexpected comfort of snow. So that prepared for the next day's climb, his equipment and order, the backpack, the axe, the two birchback containers, one holding tinder and flints, the other insulated with damp sycamore leaves, but no longer carrying live embers, the quiver, and beside it, the straight new bow with its unused string, the bird net spread, the pannier upright. He ate the last of his food, all except, oddly, a slow. Then lay on his uninjured side in the best available shelter and pillowed his head, while the snow, which would lull and warm him, spiraled out of the night and marked, as I've said, a change in the Tyrol. A climatic glitch which lasted 5,000 years until the thaw on the glacier 2 summers ago brought him to our attention, then here to the Institute. So that although I can tell you nothing of his gods or language, almost nothing of his way of life, whether he was shepherd, headman, or shaman, the last of his village, or employed in some delicate embassy, whether he moved in the forest among spirits and shades, or was himself almost a shadow, who, with a visceral roar, fell on a victim and bludgeoned his brains, whether unarrayed he would satisfy his need with a woman or child, or contrariwise was himself husband and father, a tender of flocks in the epoch of transhumans, gregarious, hierarchical, a transmitter of geographical lore, of trails, cloud changes, windbreaks, who sang at the campfire. Though I can tell you nothing of this, I can tell exactly how he died. How in his plight he couldn't string the green yew stave, he couldn't ignite the tinder to roast the songbirds, and from the decalcified traces of the humerus, I can tell he kept those last weeks one arm crooked in a virtual sling, thus giving the broken ribs time to knit, as indeed they were doing. I can guess in the interim he hoped for an Indian summer of nuts, mushrooms, fruit, a fire not quite dead, even a maggot-ridden carcass. And for a hand with the bow stave, he would have given in exchange his knife or his colored tassel with its marble bead. That one inutile item, polished so spherical and white, it seems like the slow extraneous. But everything comes down to the slow, the uneaten slow. Herders from Anatolia to the Oatsal, even to the present day, pick these sour, purplish, almost pitiless fruits. And like my grandfather Bogleman, when he dropped one in his fob, they say, a frost will sweeten it. So it is grave goods, viaticum, food for the soul on its journey, in its flight to the tip of the punctured heel or the slit tattooed into the lumbar. And when the temperature drops and the body is anesthetized, as the brain sinks into its reverie of log fires and song, of dripping fat and tree sap, even as the skin adheres to the earth, the tannins and acids disintegrate, So that now, as I put the sloe back in the ice, I tell you, it is edible, that by morning it was sweet.